Stone back at Wrigley Field, Chicago, opening day 1994. Gorgeous afternoon. And all the studies suggest that fans love seeing runs scored. And already 16 of them here today.
You know, Tom, it's funny. I kind of get a little impatient with people that talk about the beauty of the game of both football and basketball and how baseball is losing interest to a lot of fans against those two sports. Now, this is a sport that doesn't do anything to change the scoring of the game itself. In football, they're talking about the two-point conversion. They make a ruling where you can't hit the receiver after 5 yards. Basketball put in the 24-second clock.
And the three-point shot.
And the three-point shot, as well as widening the lane for the bigger player. So they do things artificially to change the game to encourage scoring. And they've done that back and forth. The rules have changed in the course of the game, but the actual rules of the game of baseball haven't changed. You score the same way. You can't hit a two-run homer with nobody on base. I mean, everything has stayed the same over these years, and still the game holds up, and still the people keep coming out. And also, another factor, it's still the only game in town where you can take the kids and see a game and get out without taking a mortgage on your house.
You got that right.
You can't do it in football, and you can't do it in basketball.
Very well put there, Professor Stone. I mean, you sum that up very quickly, concisely, precisely, everything. Here's a 2-1 to Hundley, and turns around about right-handed and can't get it. 2-2.
Bullpen up and going for the Cubs in this hitting extravaganza. And with the wind blowing out, something you very rarely see on opening day, the hitters have taken advantage of it and have come out of spring training roaring.
Hundley, 1-3, hit a solo home run back in the third inning. And he thought about that. They appeal and nothing doing, says Bob Davidson. Tom Treblehorn visiting the mound briefly. And one thing Treblehorn has talked about time and time again during spring training, he will not tolerate pitchers that do not throw strikes.
Well, leadoff walk to McReynolds in the fifth, and he scored.
That ball into shallow right center, and Sosa can't get it. Hundley, the turn at first, but he'll stop right there. Sosa nearly coming up with a diving stab.
Todd Hundley hit 228 last year, but something happens when he sees a Cub uniform and the man who's throwing it. As Sammy sees this ball drop out of his glove, he kind of took the circuitous route to this sinking line drive. But Hundley with a couple of hits today, and I don't care what he does against anybody else, he just kills the Cubs.
McReynolds, a high fly ball down the left field line. Derek May waiting. And he has it for the first out here in the New York sixth inning. Mets are leading 9-7. But a long, long game left. Well, a few other games from baseball. Montreal in the bottom of the sixth inning in front of Houston 3-1. Boy, I like that Expo team. John Smiley shutting out St. Louis through five. 4-0 Reds in front. Run down some of the American League games later. The only final. The New York Yankees opening at home beat the Texas Rangers 5-3. And you hold that Texas ball club to 3 runs, you're doing something right. And I believe Jimmy Key was the opening day starter for the Yanks.
Well, the Yankees are going to do it with just about the entire left-hand starting rotation. They got Jimmy Key. They have Terry Mulholland, late of Philadelphia. They've got Jim Abbott. They've got Bob Ojeda trying to resurrect his career. So if the teams around baseball are looking for lefties, look to the Bronx. The Yankees have them.
Yeah, the only right-hander is Melito Perez. One on, one out. Bonilla's had a quiet day. He has struck out twice and fly to center.
Jim Bullinger continues to loosen up in the bullpen. As Blaze Ilsley trying to get out of this one with out any further damage. Touched for 3 last inning.
Bonilla's hit more home runs and knocked in more runs against Cubs pitching than any other team in the National League. And I bet about 3/4 of those 26 home runs have come right here in the friendly confines.
Tommy, I just think back to that outstanding outfield at the Pittsburgh Pirates, and notably Sid Thrift, who now works as the assistant general manager to Larry Himes, put together. And you see Barry Bonds in left and Andy Van Slyke in center and Bobby Bonilla in right. Ooh. And you realize what kind of damage that team was able to do. When you look at the numbers, those guys pile up and two thirds of them now with other clubs.
And doing pretty well, I might add, particularly that guy out in San Francisco.
Yes, sir. Barry Bonds going for an unprecedented fourth MVP, and but for two votes would have been going for a fifth in a row, might I add.
Yes, please do add.
Terry Pendleton beat him out. A lot of people felt that year that Barry deserved it, although Pendleton had a magnificent season.
1-2 to Bonilla on the ground, off the mound, and let's see, Bouchel will not have a play on Bonilla at first. That'll be an infield single for Bobby Bonilla. And the Mets have two on with one out. That was just a bad break. It looked like it caught the side of the mound just before Ilsley had a play.
Well, it looks like it could have been two, but Ilsley can't get the glove down in time. It caroms off, I believe, his shoe. By the time Bouchel comes up with it, no play at first base. So a couple of men on, only one out, and a very dangerous Jeff Kent. And what Kent lacks in mobility at second, he makes up in raw power. Hit 21 last year and probably will better that this year. This is a pretty tough young hitter.
Well, he already has his first home run of the season today, and there's a sharp single in the left. They're going to wave the runner around. Here comes a throw by May, cut off, and now they have Bonilla caught. Sandberg running him to third, and Dunston will put on the tag, advancing on to second with an RBI as Jeff Kent. And that makes it a 10-7 New York lead. Boy, we have seen some bad, bad base running by both clubs here today.
Let's take a look at a changeup by Ilsley that stays up, and Kent drives it into left field. His second run batted in. Hundley is going to score, but visions of Vince Coleman by Bobby Bonilla as he rounds the bag. Once he gets hung up, though, good piece of base running because he allows Kent to go to second. On the rundown, the Cubs would have rather run Bonilla back to second and made sure that Kent stayed at first. It didn't work out that way, and now an intentional walk to Segui to face Jeremy Burnett.
And the way that Jeff Kent is going right now, he's 3 out of 4, has a homer, a double, a single, and he's batted in each of the last 3 innings. If that holds to form, he'll bat 3 more times in the game and have a triple to go for the cycle.
And this game will also be 24-20. As Bo Drabowski is going through his lineup trying to figure out how to stop the bleeding on this pitching staff. Tom Treblehorn talking about it. Now a little word with Chuck Cotillere. And as we said, Tom, looking at the team in spring training, we knew that the offense was going to be high powered. And we figured that the pitching staff was going to give up some runs, and this is going to be not the exception, but the rule this year, I believe. Games like this, although with the wind blowing out, you're going to get more runs. But I think normally you're going to see high scoring games from the Cubs this year.
Right now it's 10-7 Mets with two aboard and one man out here in the top of the sixth inning. Jeremy Burnett with a count of 0-1. Ilsley turns it loose and he swung and fouled it back. Well, I have a feeling, with all the commotion taking place in our booth right now, that we are just moments away, perhaps, from visiting with the First Lady, Hillary Rodham Clinton. Maybe. She'll be stopping by, I'm sure, sometime today. I don't know if she wants to talk to me.
Well, you never know.
Well, I certainly wouldn't ask her about any of the policies today. There's a pitch down and in, and they check his swing. They say he went around. And that will end the inning. New York getting one run on 3 hits, leaving 2. Head for the bottom of the 6th. Mets 10, Cubs 7.
This new Samsung Galaxy on Verizon's 5G network is a big upgrade.
This is Ultra, the new Samsung Galaxy S20 Ultra 5G powered by Verizon 5G Ultra Wideband.
5G Ultra Wideband is so much faster than even my home internet.
With ultra fast speeds.
In the gaming world, if you lag, you're done. With Verizon 5G Ultra Wideband, I don't worry about lag.
Now, buy one of our newest Samsung Galaxy 5G phones and get an S20 Plus on us.
You can download a movie that normally takes 20 minutes in like 20 seconds.
There's 5G, then there's Verizon 5G.
How much dogs do you have?
I got 7 dogs.
Welcome to Bay versus Ballplayer.
Cubs win on a grand slam by Hayward.
You need something you can run to that makes you happy.
I think everybody hopes to play forever.
We're mic'd up.
I tried to play Fortnite. I downloaded it. No chance.
Nah.
Catch the best Cub moments every month with the Best of Cubs YouTube on Marquee Sports Network. Marquee Sports Network presents Cubs Classics. Sammy Sosa hits home run numbers 61 and 62 from the extraordinary 1998 season.
Swanman belted number 61. Move over, Bears. Swanman, there she goes. Number 62.
Catch Slammin' Sammy swinging to history with memories and analysis from the experts. Cubs Classics premieres Monday at 7 on Marquee Sports Network.
We've always had villains to face.
Bad guys to take down.
But you?
You are the most horrible of all.
We're not here because we have to be.
We're here because we've had enough of you.
Every single one of us is mortal.
But inside of us, we're all heroes.
So stand up with us. Stand up to fight.
Stand up to cancer.
Visit standuptocancer.org to learn more.
Join Marquee Sports Network for Cubs 360.
All right, okay. Let's enjoy ourselves. They're a very talented team, the Chicago Cubs, and a very talented division.
Once you start eliminating hit and runs, bunts, all these other ways to create action, you're just sitting back for basically the 3-run home run.
That's what accountability is that knowing you're given everything you have that day to win, because so am I.
I think the Cubs can win this division. I don't see why not. I really don't.
Cubs 360, Monday at 6 on Marquee Sports Network.
The census, a special time when we count every person in each home in every neighborhood.
Do kids count?
Of course. Counting everyone in your home helps support your neighborhood by funding things like schools, hospitals, and buses. Complete the census by calling or going online, or return your form by mail.
It's easy, secure, and most important, it's totally private.
Make your family count!
This year, make sure every child counts. Visit 2020census.gov.
.10-7 ball game. New York in front. Doc Gooden to begin things against Rick Wilkins. He'll be followed by Steve Buschel and then Sean Dunston. It's been a wild game. There have been a total of 3 half innings today where nearly a run was scored. First 2 innings for New York against Mike Morgan. Bottom of the 2nd inning for the Cubs against Doc Gooden. Crooked numbers the rest of the way. See the Cubs scoring in the 1st and New York in the 3rd. And then right down the line, big, big numbers here in the middle innings. And that's a change of pace from our track record.
Well, I would think, Tommy, that the one thing the Cubs would like to do is keep this inning alive to get Tuffy Rhodes one more shot at Dwight Gooden.
Well, he would be due up 5th. The Cubs can get that far. 2-1 on Wilkins. Who has lined to right and reached on an error.
Nobody warming up in the bullpen, but Jim Bullinger, I'm sure, is ready to go if the Cubs do get at least one base runner this inning.
2-1 to Wilkins, and that one came in on him. Kind of velocity you think Doc Gooden has had here today, Stoney? That was a much debated topic a year ago about this time.
I thought his velocity is good, but I don't think it's exceptional. I don't think he's going to reach back into those days of yesteryear and have those big strikeout years.
So Wilkins beginning things in the right fashion against Gooden with a sharp single through the middle.
I'm also a little surprised because he has thrown a lot of pitches so far and nobody is warming up in that bullpen. Now granted, Dallas Green doesn't exactly have an all-star pen down there, but this is opening day. It is a beautiful opening day. It's not all that cold. You don't concern yourself with that, but you really hate to see your opening day pitcher go much over 105, 110 pitches. If they get to that point, you're really asking a lot of them.
Here's Buschel, and a ground ball that will sneak through into center field, a hit. Wilkins will stay right there after the quick turn. So consecutive singles by the Cubs here off Gooden to begin the 6th, and Dunston is coming up, and the horn is ringing. With Steve Swisher, the former Cub, answering down in the New York bullpen.
That's a former battery mate of mine, Steve Swisher. In fact, Steve Swisher came over in a trade along with me and Jim Kremel and Ken Frayling to the Chicago Cubs for your partner on the radio side, Ron Santo.
The old third baseman.
Back in winter of 1973, preceding the 1974 season in a deal that was devastating for both teams.
And I have to throw it in. Swisher, a graduate of Ohio University.
Yes, he was in the Shawnometer, making an opening day appearance at a lofty 500, 1-for-2.
And the one was a double to left center field that brought in two runs back in the fourth inning. Wilkins at second, Bouchelle over at first. Nobody out. And the Cubs are only down by three here in the last of the sixth.
And Glenn Allen Hill with a bat standing in the on-deck circle, ready to come on. There's a look at one of the most powerful men in the National League. He can really launch him.
See what Dunston's doing here. The Mets are maybe thinking about a bunt.
Well, that's why Gooden stepped off the mound as quickly as he did. Dunston taking a long look down. And he wants to see if perhaps the bunt is in order. Tony Muser, the coach at third, going through his set of signs.
Gooden getting the sign from Hundley. And now the pitch. And Dunston did not show bunt that time. A nasty hook from Gooden in there for a strike. Tailgater back up. Joined by left-hander Eric Hillman. Hillman, 6'10".
Tall left-hander Eric Hillman.
Two on, nobody out. Dunston drives one to center field. Thompson came back, brought in, went back again, and he makes a catch.
Now here's a case where a good base runner takes one extra base. And I'm talking at second base and Rick Wilkins. As soon as he saw that Ryan Thompson went back on the ball and had to go back to make the catch, you tag up because Thompson can't get anything on the throw. Wilkins went halfway. Might not come into play, but we'll take a look and see what the resolution of the Glenn Allen Hill at bat is. You can score a lot easier from third than you can from second.
So Rick still standing at second with his buddy Bouchelle over at first, and here is the aforementioned Glenn Allen Hill. Came over to the Cubs, and boy, did he tear up National League pitching. Appearing in only 31 games, he had 10 home runs, including a game winner against New York Met left-hander John Franco. Here's ball one. Hill came up highly touted in the Toronto Blue Jays organization, put up some monster numbers in 86 back in Knoxville. He hit 31 home runs and knocked in 96 runs. Things never worked out in Toronto, went from there to Cleveland and here to the Cubs for Candy Maldonado. Did he go around? Yes, he did. It's 1-1.
Well, it used to be years ago, Tom, the San Francisco Giants were known as bringing the most power through to the major leagues. They didn't develop many pitchers, but they stocked the National League with outfielders for many, many years. And of late, the talent that has come through the Toronto organization has been staggering. Not only Glenn Allen Hill, but Mark Whitten, and they both came along at the same time. Hill was a better prospect of the two, but you look around and you see a lot of Toronto players, Jeff Kent and Ryan Thompson, just on this Mets team alone. So they've used a lot of their youngsters for trades and brought up some pretty good players to their major league team.
There's a breaking ball strike. Glenn Allen Hill motioning. He didn't like that call by home plate umpire Jim Quick. He thought it was low. And he might be right.
From the southwest rooftop camera, we'll take a look at this breaking ball. No doubt it had the plate. Glenn Allen Hill thought it was down, but Jim Quick thought it was good enough.
One out, two on, 1-2 to Hill, and Gooden comes back with a fastball. Hill has been going after a number of high fastballs here during the exhibition season. Struck out a couple of times in Minnesota Saturday, once yesterday on high heat.
Well, that's the game plan. If you're looking for a scouting report, you get ahead of Hill with the breaking ball and throw a head high fastball and usually throw it by him. If Glenn Allen lays off that one, he's tough to get out.
2-2 pitch, and he fouls it away to stay alive against Dwight Gooden. I don't think anybody has left quite yet. Not the way this one's being played.
It's been an exciting game. And the Cubs still have a few more chances at Doc Gooden and the bullpen. And that's what you want to do, is get into that Met bullpen.
Wilkins started the inning with a single. Went to second on a single to center by Bouchel. Dunston a pop fly into center. So two on, one out. And New York ahead here in the last of the sixth. 10-7. Glenn Allen Hill, the tying run. Waiting on the pitch from Gooden, and now he'll back out of the box. What do you think Gooden comes with here, Stoney?
One head high fastball, and he tries to throw it right by him. But then again, I never had Doc's fastball, so that's what I would go to. See if I could get perhaps an over anxious Hill swinging at something out of the zone.
Take a look. That's what he came with. And it almost hit him. Glenn Allen Hill is most fortunate he was not struck in the head with that good and tailing fastball.
Well, he went for the head high fastball, and it got just a shade out in front of his head. We'll take another look at it as Glenn Allen Hill strides in and has this one just under the chin whiskers. Pretty good reflexes here by Glenn Allen, and that one didn't miss by much. And that rooftop camera from Southwest Airlines shows you that it missed by nary a whisker.
All right, now 3-2.
I come with a good solid curveball, and if it's a strike, Glenn Allen sits down.
All right, let's see. Two aboard, one man out. It is a 10-7 Cub lead, and the crowd looking for something to happen. Go back to the top of the order with the man who is, well, you couldn't do any more than Tuffy Rhodes has done today. Three at bats, three hits, three home runs. He's a man waiting on deck. And don't believe for a second Doc Gooden doesn't know it.
Well, I'm wondering if you go to Eric Hillman, if this inning is still around when Tuffy comes to bat. If the inning is still going, if Glenn Allen Hill does not ground into the double play. If I'm Dallas Green, I don't think I let the Doc face him again.
I don't think so.
Three of his offerings are now souvenirs.
One out, two on, 3-2 to Hill. And he came with a fastball down, and Hill stays alive by fouling it off.
I got to believe, and Tommy, we're not charting the pitches, but I know that Gooden's up over 100 pitches.
Sure.
And I would think right now that he is really starting to labor. Just looking at the fastball, and again, you can't really judge it from up here as velocity is concerned, but he doesn't have what he has on the fastball now as what he started the first couple innings with. He's probably down 2-3 miles an hour.
3-2 to Glenn Allen Hill, and he got him swinging. That's a big out for Doc Gooden. Now let's see what Dallas Green will do. He's walking out of the dugout, and the crowd standing and cheering, as there is no way Dallas Green will allow Doc Gooden to see Tuffy Rhodes again.
Well, I can't blame him. And we figured that might be the case. As Dallas Green comes out, he's asking for Eric Hillman, the left-hander. And I don't blame him.
Dallas is no dummy. All right, we'll have a break in the action.
Marquee Sports Network presents Cubs Classics. Mark Grace opening day. Relive the action of this 1996 season opener against San Diego.
Cubs win! Cubs win! Cubs win! Holy cow! Mark Grace came through!
With memories and analysis from the experts. Cubs Classics, Mark Grace opening day, today at 12 on Marquee Sports Network.
Done yet?
Yeah, sorry.
You sure?
Mm-hmm. Come on,
wild thing. If you ride, you get it. Geico Motorcycle. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more.
Relive the gripping excitement of the Cubs' run for the ring as we bring you each game leading up to the 2016 World Series victory. Beginning this Wednesday, Marquee Sports Network will replay a game nightly from the entire 2016 postseason run. Don't miss any game from this special Cubs Classic series. Cubs Classics, 2016 Run for the Ring. Premieres this Wednesday at 7 on Marquee Sports Network. A typical day at Wrigley Field.
As Chicago natives would say, it was a beautiful early May day.
A flame-throwing Cubs rookie.
We have a treat for you today. Youngster from Texas will take the mound.
A game that made history.
This is what everybody comes for, to hopefully come to that special game.
Here comes the hook. Down there, 20 strikeouts.
Kerry Wood 20, Sunday at 10 on Marquee Sports Network.
MS does suck.
MS mucks with your central nervous system. Almost everything about your body, your muscles, your organs, your ability to speak, your ability to understand, your ability to move.
MS took everything from me, everything I thought was important, everything I valued.
I used to jump in a trampoline and swim with the kids.
MS has affected me being a mom because I'm sorry.
Despite MS, I will keep riding my bike.
I will continue to be the strongest mom that I possibly can.
I will still dance with my husband.
I will continue to live the life that my daughter expects me to live.
Multiple sclerosis may be a part of who you are, but it doesn't define you.
I will never stop. I will never quit.
I'm going to keep being me.
Seven ball game. Cubs batting with two on and two out here in the last of the sixth. And with Tuffy Rhodes coming up, Dallas Green goes to left-hander Eric Hillman.
Eric Hillman at 6'10", 225 pounds out of Gary, Indiana. Makes his home now Virginia Beach. Last year at Norfolk, he was 6-2, a fine 2.21 ERA. Came to the Mets. The record turned around somewhat. He was 2-9. He made 22 starts of his 27 appearances, and a lot of people figure that Eric Hillman is going to be the number five starter. But with a number five starter probably 2 to 2.5 weeks away in the Mets scheme of things, he's working out of the bullpen, and his first assignment is the man who's hit the ball out of the park all three times he's been to bat. And there is the man of the moment, Tuffy Rhodes.
And listen to this ovation. See the numbers on Hillman in spring training. And indeed, what a way to start for Tuffy Rhodes. Graduated from the same high school as Don Zimmer, Jim Fry, Pete Rose, Eddie Brinkman. 3 home runs today for Rhodes. Can he make it number 4?
Come on.
There's ball one.
Well, Hillman is not overpowering, and although you would think at 6'10 he would have Randy Johnson type velocity, he doesn't.
Rhodes waiting. Now the pitch, and it goes to 2-0. It's interesting they're staying away from him. He's hit 3 balls to the opposite field for home runs. And well, that's the direction the wind is blowing.
Well, the one thing that Hillman knows is if he loses Rhodes, he's not going to face Sandberg.
2 on, 2 down.
Oh.
Ball 3.
Interesting decision for Tom Treblehorn. Do you give your suddenly rejuvenated number one hitter the 3-0 go after hitting 3 home runs?
Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? This is Hammer City here if it's good.
If he hits one here, he can run for whatever office he wants in the state of Illinois.
Rhodes waiting. Now the pitch. And he takes ball four, a little high. So the bases are loaded. And Dallas Green more than likely will walk the walk to the mound once again.
Well, he's got the right-hander throwing in the bullpen. And I find it somewhat surprising that he's going to allow Hillman to face Ryne Sandberg with a three-run lead. And there's Dave Tailgater.
Go figure this.
Well, Dallas, if he hits one out, the papers are going to be full of who's the next manager in New York.
All right, here's Sandberg. He's had a good day. 2 of 3 with a run scored. Bases loaded. And there's a strike at the belt from Hillman. Well, the pitcher spot is due up second in the New York seventh. But right now, the Mets are just trying to hang on to a lead. Cubs are down by 3. Wilkins, Bouchel, and Rhodes aboard. 2 men out. The 0-1 to Sandberg. Lined in the left field, but right at McReynolds to end the inning. He hit it on the button. No runs, 2 hits. 3 men left. Harry back in the seventh at the end of 6. It's still a 10-7 New York lead.
You're watching Cubs Classics. April 4th, 1994. It's Carl Tuffy Rhodes' legendary performance against the Doctor, Dwight Gooden, and those New York Mets. We're going to move ahead in the game after this break.
Loser shaves his head?
Deal.
Congratulations. You're both losers of my respect. If I had hair like yours, I wouldn't gamble it. Now, I'd take it to a supercut stylist who would obsess over every precious follicle until I looked amazing. Then I'd find a swimming pool. I'd dive in and come up and do that little hair flip thing, you know?
Refreshing.
Yeah. Miss that.
Sir, you cannot park there.
What? Why?
It's reserved for Chris Paul.
Barb, tell me what you're not seeing.
My name's not Barb. You're not Chris Paul.
Stop it, Nancy. Woo!
That's not my name.
Can I see some ID?
This is my ID.
Need a tow truck on level 1? Oh, it's Jake from State Farm.
Here's the deal. There's no replacing the real Chris Paul, just like there's no replacing State Farm.
Marley, who took my spot?
Oh, just some guy. We're taking care of it.
Okay.
You want the real deal? Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Join Marquee Sports Network for Cubs 360.
All right, okay. Let's enjoy ourselves. They're a very talented team, the Chicago Cubs, and a very talented division.
Once you start eliminating hit and runs, bunts, all these other ways to create action, you're just sitting back for basically the three-run home run.
That's what accountability is that knowing you're given everything you have that day to win, because so am I.
I think the Cubs can win this division. I don't see why not. I really don't.
Cubs 360, Monday at 6 on Marquee Sports Network.
When your psoriasis is bad, it can be hard to see what's possible. But the possibilities become clear with Taltz, the first and only treatment of its kind offering a chance at 100% clear skin. With Taltz, up to 90% of those with moderate to severe psoriasis saw a significant improvement of their psoriasis plaques. Some even saw 100% clear skin. Don't use if you're allergic to Taltz. Before starting, get checked for tuberculosis. Increased risk of infections and lower ability to fight them may occur. Tell your doctor about infections, symptoms, or if inflammatory bowel disease symptoms develop, worsen, or if you've had a vaccine or plan to. Serious allergic reactions can occur. See the possibilities. Ask your doctor about Taltz.
Allow us to reintroduce ourselves. A new retro-inspired look for the Great American Lager. This bud's for you.
With Steve Stone, here's Ryan Thompson facing Dan Plesac, the Cub left-hander. Thompson's had two out of four today. The Mets have pounded out 15 hits. John Franco getting ready for New York. One ball, two strikes.
There's a look at Plesac's numbers from last year, but he looked like a different pitcher in spring training. He threw the ball exceptionally well. As you take a look at the hits per innings pitched, and nary an earned run.
Fouled it back out of play. One ball, two strikes. Well, I see Ben Stein and Jack Leahy still in their seats in the sunshine behind the Mets dugout. Hey, struck him out. Plesac continues to pitch well, which he's done all spring long. I wonder if he can start. One out. Here's Orsolak. Bounced out his only time up. The big hitters, Vizcaino, has had three hits. Hundley has had two. Kent has had four with three RBIs. Bonilla's had two. Orsolak. One ball, one strike. Dipped that outside corner.
When Dan Plesac had his good years with Milwaukee, he had a hard biting slider. And he just threw a very good one to Orsolak.
Bouncing ball to Grace. He's got it. Steps on the back. In another well-pitched game in the American League, the hometown Red Sox defeated the Detroit Tigers 9-8. Cleveland, the next innings over Seattle, 4-3. The Yankees defeated Texas 5-3. The White Sox batting in the top of the ninth were trailing 7-2, but they've been out quite a while. In the National League, Houston is tied with Montreal 3-3 after eight. Cincinnati leads the Cardinals 4-3 at the end of seven. You can't beat fun at the old ballpark. Nothing like young love. Three balls and the strike. Vizcaino's had a fine day. He walks. You know, there is no doubt that Vizcaino is an outstanding ball player. The Cubs had four shortstops. You can only play one at a time. And nobody's going to replace Dunston. So they wanted to get some pitching. And I think Vizcaino is going to help the Mets considerably. By the same token, I think that Anthony Young is really going to be maybe a savior for the Cubs. I honestly, on what I saw yesterday, he impressed me more than any other pitcher we've had in spring training.
Well, I know he threw the ball very well yesterday, and I asked Tom Trebelhorn after throwing four innings on Sunday when he would entertain the idea of using him again, and he said he felt that he would be ready to go on Wednesday if they needed him out of the bullpen, and that's where he'll stay for a while. But Harry didn't give up anything in four innings, and he's got a fastball right around 90 miles an hour.
Yeah, and he's got a good curveball and a slider. One ball, no strikes, two out. fastball is a little high, and Wilkins goes out to talk to Plesac. Hundley has had three hits today. Big crowd on hand. Hundley, a switch hitter, like Vizcaino. Ball three. Final score, Toronto beat the White Sox 7-3. Baltimore is leading Kansas City 3-1 in the bottom of the sixth. Three balls and the strike, two out. Well, I mentioned the rooftops. I guess I was on radio at the time. A goodly crowd all the way around, from left field to right. Three balls and the strike. A hectic day. All four. And Hundley walks. So after getting two out, Plesac walks two. And now he faces a tougher hitter in Kevin McReynolds, who's had one base hit today. One out of four.
Plesac is bidding to be one of the four Cup pitchers to emerge unscored upon. And to do that, he'll have to retire McReynolds.
A nice story here, written by Howie Bisley and the Grand Rapids Press. There's a strike call. Pitch is high. Philadelphia's playing in Colorado. They're just getting underway. I guess they have the usual 80,000 there for opening day.
Well, they've got one more year of drawing 4.5, maybe 4.5 to 5 million people, Harry, and then they move into a somewhat smaller park.
There's a hot smash, base hit. Another runner's gonna score. And it's 12-7 now. McReynolds drilled a single pass Sandberg in the right field.
Second hit, first run batted in for Kevin McReynolds. Sandberg diving, the ball goes under the glove, and Sammy has some problems with it. And the hit parade continues, as now all the Cup pitchers have given up at least one today, as the Mets have pounded out 16 hits.
Well, Doc Gooden beat you 1-0 if necessary. Beat you 2-1 if necessary. Beat you 3-2, then he can beat you 6-5 or 7-6 or 8-7. Or give up three straight home runs, get knocked out of the ball game, leave with a victory in his hip pocket. There's a high fly ball to center. Should be caught. Tuffy Rhodes is there. So, only one hit. One run. Two men left. We go in the bottom of the ninth. The Mets lead 12-7.
Hair. Such an underappreciated gift. Just look what you do to it. You sacrifice it. You wear it up. You cut it yourself.
You like it?
No.
Yet there's still one place that cares more about your hair than you will ever know.
It's another big day at the office with a relaxing commute, a nice long lunch. And how about those skyscrapers? Yep, doesn't get much better than this. Run with us on a John Deere Gator, because if the path to success was easy, it wouldn't be nearly as much fun. Nothing runs like a deer. Test drive a Gator UV today.
MS does suck.
MS mucks with your central nervous system. Almost everything about your body, your muscles, your organs, your ability to speak, your ability to understand, your ability to move.
MS took everything from me. Everything I thought was important, everything I valued.
I used to jump on a trampoline and swim with the kids.
MS has affected me being a mom because I'm sorry.
Despite MS, I will keep riding my bike.
I will continue to be the strongest mom that I possibly can.
I will still dance with my husband.
I will continue to live the life that my daughter expects me to live.
Multiple sclerosis may be a part of who you are, but it doesn't define you.
I will never stop. I will never quit.
I'm going to keep being me.
Yeah, I'm married. Doesn't matter. You do that for me? Really? Yeah, I'd like that.
Who are you talking to?
It's Jake from State Farm. Sounds like a really good deal.
Jake from State Farm at 3 in the morning? Who is this?
It's Jake from State Farm.
What are you wearing, Jake from State Farm?
Khakis? Hey, do they ever ask you what you're wearing?
Yeah. Red sweater, button-down shirt. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
A typical day at Wrigley Field.
As Chicago natives would say, it was a beautiful early May day.
A flame-throwing Cubs rookie.
We have a treat for you today. Youngster from Texas will take the mound.
A game that made history.
What can you say?
This is what everybody comes for, to hopefully come to that special game.
Here comes the hook.
Kerry Wood 20, Sunday at 10 on Marquee Sports Network.
Harry Carey back in the ballpark, and knew John Franco would be in there before the day is over, but he can't get a save. The Mets are leading 12-7, and who's that? Is that Al Jackson down there?
That's Tom McCraw.
Tom McCraw. He looked a little bit like Al Jackson from the side.
He's the hitting instructor. In fact, the coaching staff is Mike Cubbage, Frank Howard, Tom McCraw, Greg Pavlik, Steve Swisher, and Bobby Wine. And there you look at John Franco coming back after a number of physical problems. Franco trying to be the reliever he once was. He was 4-3 last year, an ERA that even he wants to forget at 5.20. He picked up just 10 saves, but he had a very much injury-plagued year. And Franco at his best is really the key to this Mets team. If he can throw well, they've got a chance to win a lot of ball games. But if he really struggles, the Mets have problems.
Well, the crowd giving such standing ovation to Tuffy Rhodes, who can hit his fourth home run of the day. He's already had three straight home runs. Walked his last time up, so that's not an official time at bat. He could have four home runs and four times at bat should he hit one here. The crowd loves the nickname Tuffy. And I hope his mother and family are watching the game in Cincinnati. I didn't hear you, Arnie. No doubt about it. Every sports show on TV will have Tuffy Rhodes three home runs. First three times at bat. Takes a ball high. Twelve to seven. Ooh, he was swinging for that. That one. He really ripped, but he missed. One ball, one strike. We're in the bottom of the ninth. He had a good cut. Fouled it off.
Twice Gianfranco has either led or tied for the lead in the National League in saves. In 1988 with Cincinnati, and again in 1990 with the Mets. He was traded from the Reds to the Mets in exchange for now Cubs stopper Randy Myers.
One ball, two strikes. Base hit, 4-for-4. He didn't get a homer, but he got another hit. What a day he's had. And it's a shame we couldn't have a little better pitching after scoring 7 runs off Doc Gooden. Hey, where's the first lady sitting now? She's in the bleachers near the foul line. Sandberg, the hitter. 12-7 in favor of the Mets. Outside, ball two. Well, a base hit or two, a couple bases on balls, an error or so, a long one. You can make 5 in a hurry sometimes.
Especially with the wind blowing out as it is today.
Franco's pitch. Ball 3. And Mark Grace would be next.
Franco's last real good year was 92 when the ERA was 1.64. But even in that year, he only chalked up 15 saves. So the last couple of years, just 25 saves combined.
The bet. Strike called over the outside corner. The Cardinals have tied up Cincinnati 4-4 at the end of 8. Montreal and Houston are 3-3 going into the 10th. 3 balls, 2 strikes. The home plate's area now is in the shadow from the stand. Tuffy Rhodes. Double play ball, maybe out at second base for 1. Safe at first. Sandberg forced Rhodes from Bogart to Kemp. Here's a Buick game summary. The Mets leading 12-7. Rhodes, 3 homers his first 3 times at bat, and 4 out of 4 for the day. Kemp, 4 out of 5 with a home run for the Mets. He drove in 3 runs. Here's Grace. Grace has had 1 hit, 1 out of 3. And the Cubs have done enough hitting, scored enough runs. Ground ball, up with it. Over to first, Kemp. 2 away. And here is Derek May. He's 2 out of 4 with a 2 runs batted in.
And although he comes in a non-safe situation, Gianfranco can convince Dallas Green that the stuff is back and in the shape it was in 1992. The Mets are going to have a much sunnier disposition as a club.
Fastball inside. Sammy Sosa on deck. Twelve to seven, a 5-run lead for the Mets. There's a ground ball to right field, a base hit. Here's a runner on third. He will score. And it's a 12-8 ball game. As May drives in his 3rd run of the day with a single to right.
After limited spring training, and I mean really limited, till around 10 to 15 at bats, Derek May has come out today swinging the bat like he had 75 at bats in the spring. 3 runs driven in and 3 for 5.
There have been 20 runs scored and 30 hits in this game. There's a drive foul. Way foul. Let's see, they have 18 hits, and Cubs have had 14. That's 32 hits. 20 runs on 32 hits. The accent has been on the hitting, not the pitching. Swung and a miss. Sosa fanned twice against Gooden and then tapped back to him. Then he bounced on the seventh off Hillman. Well-made in favor of the Mets. There's a high pop fly coming in. Orsulak under it, makes a catch, falls down, holds on to the ball, and the Mets have won this ball game by the score of 12-8.
I think not only I was shocked, I think anybody that's a baseball fan was shocked. Tuffy was kind of a guy that's been up and down for you know, a couple different teams, and he ended up making our ball club, ended up leading off for us, and not only the three home runs, but who he hit it off, one of the best pitchers I ever faced, and that was Dwight Gooden. And if you watch the three home runs closely, they all seem to hit about the same seat in left center field, all three of them to the opposite field and left center field. I mean, within a couple of fans of each other for all three of them. It was an incredible, incredible feat. And unfortunately, we didn't win that ball game. That's crazy, isn't it?
So Tuffy Rhodes with plenty of milestones on that April day. Rhodes becoming the first player in Major League Baseball history to go yard three times in his first three at-bats of a season, the first to hit three home runs in one game off of Doc Gooden, and the second player in history with three long balls on opening day following George Bell of the Blue Jays. That was back in 1988. Now, Rhodes finished his Major League career with just five more home runs after that historic opening day, and he was out of the show less than 2 years later. However, Rhodes, he would later continue his career and powerful display in Japan for 14 seasons, amassing an impressive 464 home runs over said span. Now, that's going to do it for this edition of Cubs Classics. So for everyone here at the Marquee Sports Network, I'm Cole Wright. Thanks for watching.